Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless before him in love, he destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to the counsel of his will. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's sermon comes from our text in Ephesians, and I entitled it Blessings of the Church, because in Ephesians chapter 1, Paul gives us a list of the blessings that we have as Christians or in Christ. But before we actually get to the text, first of all, I'd like to introduce my wife. This is my lovely wife, Dawn. She'll be giving me the countdown. I want to take you into the world of Ephesus. Hopefully that makes this book come alive. So what's going on in Ephesus? As Paul writes this letter, what is life in Ephesus like? Why would Paul have to write this letter? Why would he want to say the things that he says? So in chapter 1, he's going to give us all the blessings that we have. But first, let's look at that in light of the background. So I have my chart here. Hopefully you can see it. What was life like in Ephesus for Joe or Jane, average Ephesian? So imagine we're in Ephesus right now. Okay, this is the church in Ephesus, and I'm not Paul, because Paul wrote the letter, he's in jail already. And you and I are Joe and Jane Ephesus, and out there is first century Ephesus. Well, in politics, what's going on in politics? What's the political climate in Ephesus at this time? Well, all you have to do is say Caesar rules, and you kind of get an idea of how awesome. Caesar is absolute ruler. We live here in Ephesus. It is not a democracy. It is not a representative republic. Nobody cares what you think. Mm-hmm. You're not going to get to vote for anything. The rule of law is whatever Caesar declares it to be today. Today, he may say, you know what? There's no more church. Today, Christianity is illegal. In fact, there was one Caesar who actually made his horse emperor for a day. There was another Caesar who went into this field and he had a huge man-made lake dug. And then they brought naval ships. They filled it with water. They made a lake so that they could reenact naval battles. Okay, imagine how much federal money that costs. So with Caesar, the only rights you have in Ephesus is you have the right to be obedient to Caesar today. That's it. You don't have any other rights. It's not a democracy. Nobody cares what we might think about politics. Now imagine we're as Christians. This is why Christians were so offensive. So our sister talks about sometimes our family and our friends get offended as Christians. I mean, we walk out of here, out of our little church in Ephesus, and we go to tell our friends and our family, you know what, actually Jesus Christ is Lord. And they say, no, Caesar's Lord. And we say, no, Jesus Christ is Lord. Well, who is Jesus Christ? Well, there is this Jewish carpenter who lived way over in Palestine, and they crucify him. But the disciples claim that he rose from the dead, and he sits on the throne of the universe. He's Lord. He rules and reigns over all the cosmos. And our friends say, well, actually, Caesar rules. And I noticed that a lot of your friends are going to the Colosseum and getting eaten by lions for believing that your Jesus is Lord. So how's that really working for you? Standing up to Caesar and telling him that he's not really king. How's that working for you, Christian? Economics. In economic life in Ephesus, there is no middle class. There's the ultra rich and the ultra poor. And in fact, most of us are poor. Most of the church, the early church, was made up of really very poor people. We're either poor or slaves. At least in Rome, but probably representative in all the empire. It's estimated that one out of every three people were slaves or former slaves. Okay, so if we are the church in Ephesus, you can count off 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. Every third person in this room is either currently a slave or a former slave. There is economic persecution happening, which actually ties in with the religious element, what's happening in the religion. See, because here in Ephesus, we as Christians, we don't worship Caesar. We don't worship the 33 million gods of the ancient Roman world. We don't believe in any of the, we've rejected the principalities, the powers, the demonic spirits. And you'll notice in Ephesians, both in chapter 1 and in chapter 6, Paul gives a list of the demonic forces out there. Why? Well, because they're very real, and they have arrayed themselves against God and against his people, and we in Ephesus know that the spiritual realm is very real. It affects us every day. And so when we became Christians, we said, you know what? We don't worship. Mom and Dad, guess what? I got good news. All our family gods and the gods of the empire, the 33 million gods that protect absolutely everything. There was not one aspect of life in the Roman Empire or in Roman religion or mystery religions that was not governed by a god or a principality or a spirit or a power or a demon. And we go home, we say, guess what? I was at a rally. This guy, Paul, preached, and he told me that I could be saved, and I went forward, and I got saved, and so now I've given up all our gods. What do you think your family's going to say? Mm-hmm. What do you think your employer's going to say? You're not working here. I don't want somebody who's abandoned the God. You want to bring the wrath of the gods down on me? So we're going to get excommunicated from our families. You're probably going to get fired. If you own a business, do you think people are going to shop at your business if it's not protected by the gods? No. But you say, no, but you don't understand. I've got a different God, a more powerful God. I don't need 33 million gods. I've got one all-powerful God who rules the world. And they say, really, who is this God? Well, they crucified a Jewish carpenter back in Israel, and they said he rose from the dead, and he sits on the throne of the universe. And your friends and family go, you're crazy. And you're not working here, and I'm not going to your shop, and don't even think about coming home for Sunday dinner. You see, economic persecution, this has happened throughout church history in the former Soviet Union. Technically, it was legal to be a Christian in the Soviet Union, but you weren't going to get any decent jobs. They were going to hand you a broom and say, go sweep the streets. That's about all your family's going to get to do because you're Christian. There is no upward mobility. There's no opening your own business. You want to be a Christian in China or North Korea or some of these communist countries? Here's a broom. That's what you and your family are going to do until Caesar decides something. Religion. Ephesus was the home of the goddess Artemis. Now, she was one of the famous gods in the pantheon. And her temple, which was one of the seven ancient wonders of the world, was right here in Ephesus. So we got all kinds of religious competition. Christianity is not the hottest thing in town. Artemis is. And of course, she was a fertility deity. So all kinds of lewd and bizarre and strange and disgusting sexual practices went into her worship. So as Christians go out and we say, well, you know, actually, you know, we're trying to, Jesus is Lord. They say, well, no, Artemis is Lord. And there's her temple right over there. You guys, you know, when you get your little Presbyterian church here, this is fine. Maybe you meet in homes. Maybe you meet underground. But Artemis rules. You see, in Acts chapter 19, when Christianity is starting to take off, it's getting a little more popular, it's causing economic problems for the idol makers. There's a guy by the name of Demetrius, and he makes little silver idols of Artemis. And there's a problem because people aren't buying as many of these idols anymore as they used to because Christians are saying, hey, Artemis isn't really God. Jesus is really God. And people are starting to believe it. And it's hurting the idol makers economically. So Demetrius, he gets all the idol makers together, and he says, hey, we got a problem. These Christians are leading all these people to Jesus, and it's hurting business. So guess what they do? They gather the people of the town together, they start a big persecution, and a riot breaks out. They've got rioting in the streets of Ephesus. Morals. Total sexual perversion. Probably the way you could summarize the sexual ethic in Ephesus is, you could have sex or sexual relations with anyone, for any reason, at any time. No questions asked. You could have sex with anyone at any time for any reason. For the men, we have wives to give us legal heirs, someone to pass on our inheritance to. Other than that, we had mistresses for our, what they used to call daily maintenance, and we had prostitutes for pleasure. So the family unit, it wasn't about two people who fell in love in high school or college and you came together and you love each other and you want to raise kids in a loving family. The wife was usually much younger and she was property. She was just there to give you kids. Otherwise, sexually, this is for men and women, you are free to do whatever you want. Jeff Epstein, guy's a hero in Ephesus. Not a bad thing what he was doing in Ephesus. sex trade, sex industry, sex trafficking, all of this is perfectly acceptable because we're all participating in it. And let's say we are the church. Pretend for a moment that we are the church in Ephesus. We listened to Paul, we heard the Christians, and we became followers of Christ. We've all come out of this. This was all us. This was our lives. We participated in all of it. And with morals as well, how perverse it was sexually. Mentorships. One of the prominent features of a mentorship, so an older man would take on a younger man and mentor him or teach him. One of the main components of that relationship is that the older man would be able to have sexual relations with the young man or the boy that he was mentoring. Okay, so there is no Judeo-Christian ethic. There's no foundation of society of some sort of biblical worldview or biblical ethic. So morality is, there is no morality. We're up against Artemis and all the mystery religions. Christians are standing against 33 million gods. We've got one crucified and resurrected Jewish carpenter versus 33 million gods. Economically, we're persecuted. And politics, we have no rights. It's just whatever Caesar does today. So the question, how does Joe or Jane Ephesus feel in this background, in this world? How does he feel? What are some of his primary emotions? What does he think? What does Joe and Jane Ephesus think? Now that they're Christians, and they've got to try and live in this world. Yeah. Probably the main feeling that they have is fear. They live in fear. Because how do we go and survive and live and thrive and make any kind of life in this world? Okay, so the reason that Ephesians is important is because, one, that ain't just Ephesus, is it? That look familiar? Mm-hmm. We can walk out of that door and we're in Ephesus. So Ephesus, or the book of Ephesians, answers two questions. Number one, how do we as Christians live in a world that has gone absolutely nuts? How do we as Christians live in a world, go out and actually be Christians in a world that is just crazy? It's crazy town out there. And then the second question is, what does that actually mean to be the church? We sit here and we gather as Christians. We have Canadians, we have Americans, and we're from all over, all kinds of different backgrounds. But we come together united as the church. And this Presbyterian church is one local expression of a body of Christ worldwide. And so whether you're Catholic or Orthodox or one of the 38,000 Protestant denominations, we are members of the church. And how does the church be who she's supposed to be in a world? This is crazy. Okay, so with that as a background, we're going to look at just a few highlights of Ephesians chapter 1, the passage that we read. I titled the sermon, The Blessings of the Church, because one of the good news that we have for the world is, as crazy as that world is, we walk out and we say, look, Jesus offers you a different way to be. What Jesus offers us is life in the midst of this craziness. You can come out of that and find freedom and wholeness and health and well-being and every spiritual blessing. But what does that look like? What does that mean? What's so special about the church? Well, we have Christ. But what does Christ do for the church? So that's what we're going to look at in chapter 1 of Ephesians. In chapter 1, Paul gives us a list of what he calls every spiritual blessing. So I'm just going to walk you through, give an overview, and then just highlight one in particular. Well, the first thing we notice that the text says is, it says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. Now, for those of you who were English majors, what tense is that? Past tense, yes. God has blessed us. In other words, it's done. It's a finished work. You've already got it. Whatever God's done, He's already done it. You don't need to wait for it. God has blessed us with every. Has God forgotten any? Has He left out any? Has He held back any? Is He waiting for you to beg for more? No. Every spiritual blessing. What's a blessing? A blessing is a gift. God has given you every possible gift He can give you. But notice they're spiritual in nature. And so as we unpack some of these things that Paul lists, they're primarily spiritual. They're not physical. Why? Because the kingdom of God is of a different realm. And it's so that every Christian in every era, in every demographic, in every social category or class, in every continent, in every age, partakes of the same blessing. When I was in Manila, my wife and I actually met on the mission field. In Manila, there is a huge garbage dump. In some cases, the garbage is stacked several stories high. Well, people live there. They take the garbage, they make homes, and they live in this garbage dump. In fact, recently there was a story where a small minor tremor or something happened, and some of this garbage that was several stories high collapsed and slid down and destroyed a whole bunch of people's homes. And they live in a garbage dump. We were in Kenya, in Africa. Same thing, one of the poorest slums in Kenya, in Nairobi. Same thing, they live among garbage. But you know what? They have all of those same, their churches, and we went to minister in those churches and to do outreach with them. Those churches are just as rich as our church because they have every spiritual blessing that God can give and has already given. So what are those spiritual blessings? Well, the first thing that Paul says is God has given us every spiritual blessing in Christ. And that's a very important phrase for Paul. In Christ. Notice in. It's a place. It's a realm. It's a reality in which we live. And so the analogy that I use in class for my students is a fish in a fishbowl. I was going to bring an actual fish in a fishbowl. I thought that would have been a little more powerful as an illustration, but it's hot out, and if the fish dies, I probably would get in trouble. But the idea of a fish in a fishbowl. The fish is in the water. Okay, the fish has a life-giving union, a life-giving connection to the water. The fish is in this reality of participating in the life of the water. In the water, it has the oxygen that it needs, it gets the food that it needs. You take the fish out of the water, it will die. Well, for Paul, Christ is the water and we're the fish. We are vitally connected to Him. There's this life-giving union that we have with Christ. And this is not the, you know, I pray a prayer, maybe I read my Bible, I show up for church. None of those things guarantee a living, dynamic relationship with the living, resurrected Lord. Why it was so important that Jesus resurrected? So that we could have a living, dynamic, life-giving relationship with Him. So for Paul, if you're not in Christ, if you're not participating in that life-giving relationship with Jesus, you don't have any of these. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter how many times you show up at church. Doesn't matter what you, doesn't matter. If you don't have a life-giving relationship with Jesus, you don't have it. Which is why it's so important for us as the church, when we go out of here, we're not inviting them, we're not inviting our unsaved friends or our non-Christian friends simply to show up for church or simply to pray a prayer. We are inviting them into a life-giving relationship, a life-giving union with Jesus, where He feeds our soul and gives us resurrection life. Paul sums it up in verse 7, says we have redemption. So all of these blessings, the big heading is redemption. Well, what's redemption? Redemption is a word that comes from slave market. It's what you did when you bought someone out of the slave market in order to set them free. So Paul says that Jesus walked into the slave market, and here we are in our slavery. Okay, we're slaves to sin, death, and evil, and Satan, and Caesar, and all that. We're slaves to our own fallen nature before we become a Christian. And so all of us, some of us here in Ephesus, we literally are socially still in that status of slavery. But we were all spiritual slaves. And we stood there on the block being auctioned off. We had in our chains and our rags. And Paul says that Jesus comes along, he comes to the slave market, and he buys us out. And Ephesians 1 says that the price that Jesus paid was his own blood. He died to set us free. So when we have that expression, we say that as Christians all the time, we sing it in our hymns. What does it mean? It means we were slaves in the slave market, and Jesus died. He gave his life for ours that we could walk out of that slave market. So Jesus walks into the slave market. He goes to the guy who's the money changers. He takes his blood, shed at the cross. He says, here, I'm buying this one, and 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 this one. And he buys us out of our spiritual slavery. The slavery to sin, and death, and evil, and Satan, and Caesar, and our own sinful flesh. And one of the blessings that we find in this list is adoption. That we have become sons and daughters. When we were alienated from God, we didn't know him, we were lost in our slavery, Jesus goes into the slave market, he buys us out and says, tell you what, I'm not just going to buy you out and set you free and I hope you make it. He says, I'm going to make you sons and daughters of God. And he gives us a whole new life. He gives us an entirely new way to be. Fish in the fishbowl, where we draw our life from him. Why? Because we've got to go out here and live as the church. The only way we do this, the only way we live is as the church, is by drawing on the life of Christ in our new life that he has given us. Christianity is actually about life. Forgiveness, that's a nice bonus. We are forgiven. But it's not like you're only in the courtroom and God says, you know what, I forgive you. Go in peace. He says, I tell you what, I'm going to forgive you, and I'm also going to raise you from the dead. I'm going to take you as these little fish, I'm going to put you in the fishbowl, so that not only are you forgiven, but you actually partake of, share in, the very life of the risen Christ himself. That you are filled with the life of Jesus. He's the water, we're the fish, and we can actually live in that world, and we can go out and conquer in the name of Christ. If you look at Acts chapter 19, it says the word of the Lord went everywhere. People are getting saved all over the place. It says it was the word of the Lord that prevailed mightily. So did that change? Did our culture change? Yeah, it changed. Changed because the body of Christ, drawing on the life of Christ, lived different kinds of lives than we used to live, walked out of these doors and preached Christ. We saw a whole bunch of our friends come to Christ to have them get filled with new life, and everything changed. So yes, we were chosen. I know we're in a Presbyterian church, descendants of John Calvin theologically. You can think whatever you want about election. We can have that discussion. But for Paul, the end game of election is that we would be holy and blameless. That we would walk out of here and live holy lives. One of the things that the early church, one of the reasons the early church changed the world is because the church walked out of here and lived holy life. And this world said, hey, there's something different about these people. There's something radically different about these Jesus followers. They're not doing this stuff. And I'm like, oh my gosh, so-and-so, he's my neighbor, he's on my softball team. Mm-hmm. He claims he's a Christian. Do you know he actually loves his wife? He's faithful to his wife and he loves his kids. He doesn't got any mistresses anymore. He stopped having relationships with all his... The guy's actually sexually faithful to his... Unheard of! You know what? I went and I did business with that guy. He's actually an honest businessman. I know he's a Christian. But if you really want a good deal and you want to do business, go to that guy. He's actually a good guy to do business. But it's about being in Christ. We've got the Holy Spirit. Not only are we fish in a fishbowl, we are filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay, so in closing, why is all this important? I'm going to come back in a couple of weeks and we'll finish up with Ephesians. But all this is important because, again, there's two questions that we've got to answer. The first question is, how do we as Christians live in a world that is just nuts? And it is nuttier now in 2020 than it's ever been. Like, I talk to my parents, and they say, oh yeah, I remember the riots in 1970. My parents are from New York, and we had all kinds of really crazy riots in the late 60s, early 70s. They lived through World War I, or World War II. My dad was a kid in World War II. They lived through the 60s. They said, we've seen it all. We've seen plagues, and we've seen depressions, and we've seen war, and we've seen it all. We've never seen it all at the same time, though. Never seen it all at the same time. The world is just absolutely, the last time I was here, I talked about a shaking. God is allowing the world to be shaken wisely. Things that will fall, so that God can build what he wants to build. What does he want to build? He wants to build a church. This is what it looks like. So we've got to answer the question, how do we as Christians live in a world that is absolutely not so right now? In order to do that, we have to answer the question, what does it mean to even be the church? Is showing up here enough? What does it mean to be the church? And what does it mean to be filled with the life of Jesus himself? What does it mean to be in Christ? So Lord, we do thank you for what Paul said. As I pray for my brothers and sisters, as Paul prayed at the end of Ephesians 1, that our hearts and our minds and our spirits would be enlightened by your Holy Spirit, that you, by your grace and by your illumination, would show us what it means to be the body of Christ right here in Polson/Ephesus, what it means to come here every week and be filled up with you, that we might walk out of here and make a difference in our version of Ephesus. What it means to be fish in a fishbowl, that we can draw on the very life of Jesus. So Lord, we pray that you would show us that in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn is number 464, Joyful, Joyful. Ephesians chapter 3, Paul prays, now to him who is able to do far abundantly more than we can either ask or think,
To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.